actually start on time. Governors are usually.
We're ready to begin. If you go ahead and introduce yourself. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm a little hard to hear with the mask on. Do we feel comfortable if I take it off just while I speak? Thank you. Good afternoon to all of you. I am Emily Sovel, and I'm here on behalf of the Hyde County State's Attorney's Office. I'm joined today by Mike Moore, the Beadle County State's Attorney. And today we are here to announce the charging decisions regarding the pedestrian vehicle crash involving South Dakota Attorney General Jason Ravnsborg. Before we proceed with disclosing the charging decisions, I would like to first speak to the lack of comment throughout this investigation. I'd like to point out that there has been a very deliberate separation from our offices and any political officials, media, inquiries from the public, and the reason was twofold. First, I wanted there to be no ability for any person to assert that there was any political influence whatsoever on the decision that was made with respect to these charges. I certainly respect the public's thirst for knowledge. It involved a high-ranking official in this state. But as you all well know, investigations are typically not public as they develop, and I did my very best to preserve the integrity of this investigation throughout. And as a very practical matter, the Hyde County State's Attorney's Office is a part-time office. We are typically manned by one to two, sometimes three people. And there was a plethora of requests for information, for comments, for interviews. And quite frankly, had I taken the opportunity to return every one of those, my office would have gotten nothing else done from September of this year. So had I picked one to communicate with and make comment with, two, there would have been some type of concern of favoritism. So I simply want to point out, it wasn't because I meant any disrespect to the press. It was just a matter of practical reality that we couldn't respond to every inquiry. I would like to also very briefly speak to the timeline in this case. I know there's been a lot of commentary that somehow this was an untimely investigation. I would point out that the final evidence in this case returned to our offices earlier in February. I originally was optimistic that we might have the final information back by December of 2020. That simply did not happen. Regardless of that, this just was not an untimely investigation. Laboratory review, technical evidence, those sorts of things, they take time to come back, and it wouldn't have been unrealistic for our offices to expect this to conclude 6 months from the time of the incident or up to a year. There was no delay by the North Dakota Bureau of Criminal Investigation. There was no delay by the reconstructionists that were involved. There was no delay by the prosecutors. It was a smart decision for prosecutors to await all of the evidence before we came to our final decision in this case. I'm going to limit discussions on the evidence because this is still an active case. What I'm going to do for you all is I'll recap some of the facts that have already been released publicly. I will then read through the charging documents for you. I will then defer to Mr. Moore if he has any questions, and he will go ahead and proceed with some statements if he has them. And at the conclusion, please respect the fact that we are not going to delve deeply into the evidence of this case. As you were previously made aware, on September 12th of 2020, Jason Ravnsborg was the driver of a Ford Taurus that struck and killed Joseph Beaver of Highmore, South Dakota. Ravnsborg was the sole occupant of a Ford Taurus at the time of the accident, and it occurred within Hyde County, just west of Highmore city limits. It's also been disclosed to you previously that that impact occurred outside of the lane of travel on the north shoulder of Highway 14. The Attorney General's 911 call was made at 10:24 on the night in question. And after local law enforcement arrived on scene, a tow truck was called to tow Ravnsborg's vehicle. Due to the expected wait time of the tow truck, Ravnsborg was lent a courtesy vehicle to return to his home in Pierce, South Dakota. The morning after the accident, Ravnsborg returned the vehicle that had been borrowed to him by law enforcement the night prior. And in the process of returning that car, the Attorney General assessed the area near the debris where the accident had occurred. It was at that time that he located the body of who was later determined to be Mr. Joseph Bieber. Ravnsborg reported his findings to local law enforcement, who then worked to secure the scene and called for an outside agency assist. Based upon Ravnsborg's position as our South Dakota Attorney General, the outside agency assist for the investigation was made by our neighbor to the north, the North Dakota Bureau of Criminal Investigation, and that agency headed this investigation throughout. Accident reconstruction has been provided by our local South Dakota Highway Patrol, and both agencies have carefully and thoroughly investigated this matter. And the reports have been now made available to and reviewed by the Hyde County State's Attorney's Office, as well as the Assisting State's Attorneys. Again, due to the high-profile nature of this case, full-time State's Attorney Michael Moore, who is with me today, of Huron, South Dakota, as well as Pennington County State's Attorney Mark Vargo, have generously shared their time to help review. I know there's going to be some questions about the obvious absence of Minnehaha County State's Attorney Crystal Johnson, who was originally assisting as well. When they had the transition of office with Minnehaha County State's Attorneys, the new administration needed all hands on deck, and that is an extremely busy office. I understand that. And regardless of that transition, she provided a plethora of knowledge. She shared a lot throughout the process, and I would like to sincerely thank her and all of the assisting state's attorneys for that same. With that, I will read to you the complaint against Jason R. Ravnsborg. It states that on or about the 12th day of September in 2020, Hyde County, State of South Dakota, Jason R. Ravnsborg did commit the following offenses. Count one, operating a motor vehicle while using a mobile electronic device in violation of SDCL 32-26-47.1. In that the defendant did operate a motor vehicle east of Highmore city limits while using a mobile electronic device. Count two, lane driving in violation of SDCL 32-26-6. In that the defendant did, while driving a motor vehicle on a roadway divided into two lanes, fail to drive said vehicle as nearly as practicable entirely within a single lane and did move from such lane without first ascertaining that such movement could be made safely. Count three, careless driving, in that the defendant did drive a vehicle upon a highway without due caution, at a speed or in a manner so as to endanger any person or property, not amounting to reckless driving as defined by 32-24-1. All contrary to the statute in such case made and provided against the peace and dignity of the state of South Dakota. All of the charges are misdemeanor charges. And you will note when you review this publicly filed document that Mr. Ravnsborg is charged with operating a motor vehicle while using a mobile phone, electronic device. That occurred east of Highmore city limits, and as you all well know, the accident in question occurred west of Highmore city limits. All evidence indicates to us that the Attorney General was not on his phone at the time of the accident. The evidence does indicate, however, that Ravnsborg was outside of his lane of travel. I know there's been a lot of speculation, a lot of questions about whether there would be some type of a homicide or a manslaughter charge in this case. And again, I'm not going to go into a lot of evidence for you, but what I'm going to do is clarify those statutes. For a vehicular homicide in South Dakota, it requires that one be under the influence of alcohol, drugs, or substances in a manner and a degree prohibited by law without design to affect death, but that ultimately, after negligent actions, results in the death of another human being. That's simply not applicable in this case. The toxicology reports were previously released. The Attorney General was not under the influence of any alcohol or drugs. There were questions about the delay in the blood draw. There was a very, very thorough investigation conducted for every step that was taken by him in the hours preceding, and nothing was indicative of him being under the influence of any alcohol or drugs. With respect to the speculation on a manslaughter charge, I will explain to you that in South Dakota, SDCL 22-16-20 states, Any reckless killing of one human being, including an unborn child, by the act or procurement of another, which under the provisions of this chapter is neither murder nor manslaughter in the first degree, nor excusable nor justifiable homicide, is manslaughter in the second degree. That is a class 4 felony. There is a very specific articulation of what reckless means within the provisions of that manslaughter statute. The state must import a conscious and unjustifiable disregard of a substantial risk that the offender's conduct may cause a certain result or may be of a certain nature. A person is reckless with respect to circumstances when he consciously and unjustifiably disregards a substantial risk. Our high courts have explained that for someone's conduct to be deemed reckless, it's more than just a mere ordinary negligence standard. Operation of a motor vehicle in violation of a law is not in and of itself sufficient to constitute the recklessness required for that manslaughter statute, even if a person is killed as a result thereof. I know that for every prosecutor, there's likely a very visceral reaction to traffic accidents that result in fatalities. Prosecutors' jobs, however, are to look at the facts, look at the evidence, apply the laws and the standards that they're provided, and that's exactly what's been done in this case. This time, I'm going to defer over to Mr. Moore, and then we'll take the opportunity to answer a few questions.
Thank you. As Emily stated, my name is Michael Moore. I'm the state's attorney in Beadle County. I've served as state's attorney in Beadle County since 1997. First, I'd just like to send my sympathies and prayers out to the family of Joseph Beaver. This is obviously a tragic incident that took his life way too soon. I'd also like to echo the comments that the investigation was second to none. I've been involved in numerous homicide cases in my 20-plus years of prosecution, numerous sexual assault cases, numerous cases similar to this where there's vehicle pedestrian accidents, and the investigation done in this case by the North Dakota Bureau of Investigation, the Highway Patrol, and the accident reconstructionists, they went well above and beyond what I've ever seen in an investigation before. Anything that was asked of them by the prosecution team, they did it. They did it in a timely manner. They provided us what we asked for in order for us to make a decision. I did get to visit with the victim's family this morning. They obviously don't like our decision in this case. But as we all know, that victims don't make that decision. That's why there's independent review. That's why there's prosecutors that are elected by the people. That's our job. We owe it to not only to Joe Beaver, but to the Attorney General Ravnsborg to do an unbiased, fair review of the facts and apply it to the law. That's why Emily put together the team that she did for input, and the decision was then finally hers. I'm going to make some comments. My comments will be strictly to the fact of whether Ravnsborg is responsible, criminally responsible, for the death of Joseph Beaver. Emily talked a little bit about the laws. There's a couple things I want to point out as I'm discussing this. Vehicle homicide, she mentioned. That requires the driver of the vehicle to be intoxicated, either under the influence of alcohol or drugs. But it also requires the driver to drive in a negligent manner. And I think that is important to know that it not only do you have to be intoxicated, but you also have to be negligent. A lot of people don't realize that. In those cases in the state of South Dakota, negligence can be defined as a traffic violation. So if that intoxicated person is speeding, if they're driving outside the lane, we can bring that prosecution. But if we don't have any negligent driving, we are prohibited from bringing that prosecution. In this case, that law does not apply because Ravnsborg was not intoxicated at the time. But keep in mind the negligent part. Also, many states throughout this country have a negligent homicide law. South Dakota does not. Thus, that law doesn't exist here. We cannot apply that law. And I just want to mention that this has been, in my field as prosecution, we've known this for years. The legislature is aware of this. And the last time a negligent homicide bill was presented to the legislature, I think, was in 2006. It was House Bill 1108, and it was defeated in committee. I believe the vote was 10-2. And one thing about that House bill was, if it would have passed, it specifically excluded traffic accidents as negligent homicide. So that leaves us as prosecutors with reviewing manslaughter in the second degree. Emily read you what that is, the reckless killing of another person. She read to you what reckless was defined as in this state. So with that in mind, I'll go over a few facts that I believe are relevant to that discussion. First, Ravnsborg was the driver of the vehicle that struck and killed Mr. Beaver. Ravnsborg was the sole occupant of that vehicle. He was traveling about 67 miles an hour at the time of impact. Based on the accident reconstruction and doing the math on that, if you're traveling 67 miles an hour, you're going about 98 feet per second. And those numbers are important when we're doing the accident reconstruction, when we talk about time. The impact happened outside the lane of travel, just west of Highmore. At the time of the impact, Ravnsborg was not a distracted driver. And we know that because his phones were analyzed. He had two phones with him. They were both analyzed, and his phones were locked approximately 1 minute and 15 seconds prior to the impact, which would have been east of Highmore. He traveled about approximately a mile in that 1 minute and 15 seconds. So I'll give you the numbers and the timeline on that. At 10:22 and 22 seconds p.m., the phones were locked. Approximately 1 minute and 15 seconds later, at 10:23:37, Ravnsborg was west of Highmore and struck Mr. Beaver. Approximately 15 seconds later, at 22:23:52, Ravnsborg's vehicle was stopped. 14 seconds after that, at 10:24:06, Ravnsborg's phone was unlocked. And 16 seconds after it was unlocked, at 10:24:22, the 911 call was made. We know from the phone records that Ravnsborg walked the area of the accident. He actually walked by where Mr. Beaver was. And he was using his flashlight on his phone at the time. The Hyde County Sheriff also walked the area about 10:44 p.m. Should note that the thorough investigation, we were unable to determine why Ravnsborg was outside the lane of travel, how long he had been outside the lane of travel, or whether Ravnsborg knew he was outside the lane of travel. So knowing those facts, we answer the question, did his conduct amount to recklessness under South Dakota law? As noted above, in order for him to be criminally liable for Mr. Beaver's death, the state must prove beyond a reasonable doubt that Ravnsborg's driving was reckless. Negligent driving would not be enough to amount to a criminal charge in the state of South Dakota. The people of South Dakota and the legislature have rejected the idea of criminal responsibility as it relates to negligent conduct. 31 years ago, Justice Henderson wrote, when presented with the question of criminal liability as related to the death as a result of an automobile accident, and I quote, "But if negligent or careless driving or a thoughtless omission spawns manslaughter prosecutions in this state, the courts will be flooded with all these types of prosecutions. If there is a vacuum in the law, i.e. a blind spot between manslaughter and careless driving, our legislatures at the state capitol should fill that gap." In response, as I noted before, to Justice Henderson and what he stated in that opinion, in 2006, the legislature specifically rejected the idea of negligent homicide. South Dakota Supreme Court has given prosecutors further guidance in this area. The Supreme Court stated, not every violation of the law or unlawful act in operation of motor vehicle will render the operator criminally responsible for deaths which may result. Such an operator to be criminally responsible must evidence a disregard of human life or an indifference to the consequences of his acts. This is based on the sound principle that there must be found from the evidence some degree of culpability behavior or reckless disregard for the safety of others before a conviction may be sustained. Criminal responsibility for death resulting from operation of motor vehicle in violation of the law will result only if the violation is done in such a manner as to evidence a reckless disregard for the safety of others. Mere carelessness or inadvertence or thoughtless omission is insufficient. The Supreme Court, since 1990, the Supreme Court has had the opportunity to address this issue further. In 1999, they said, whether the conduct is perceived as negligent or reckless depends on the awareness of the risk the driver's behavior creates. In 2005, a reckless actor is aware of the risk and disregards it. A negligent actor is not aware of the risk, but should have been aware of it. As recently as 2012, the Supreme Court stated, for someone's conduct to be deemed reckless for purposes of second-degree manslaughter, he or she must consciously disregard a substantial risk. Based on the Supreme Court guidance, the state must introduce evidence that would allow a trier of fact to conclude beyond a reasonable doubt that the driver was aware of the dangerous nature of his conduct and disregarded it. When you apply the law, as I just stated, to the facts of this case, this is what you end up with. There is no evidence indicating that Ravnsborg's travel outside the lane of travel was done in such a manner to suggest a reckless disregard for the safety of others. We do not know when Ravnsborg left the lane of travel. We do not know why Ravnsborg was outside the lane of travel. We do not know if Ravnsborg realized he was outside the lane of travel. We must provide evidence that would allow a trier of fact to conclude that Ravnsborg was aware of the dangerous nature of his conduct. No such evidence exists. At best, his conduct was negligent, which is insufficient to bring criminal charges in South Dakota. As I mentioned, this is a tragic accident which took the life of Mr. Beaver way too soon. The victim's remedy is in civil court, not criminal court. When the facts of a case fall well below the legal threshold for criminal charges, the case should not be presented to a grand jury. To do so would be a violation of prosecutors' obligations.
Thank you. And again, thank you to all of the assisting state's attorneys in this case. At this time, I'll open it up for a few questions.
Austin Goss, Dakota News Now. I wanted to ask, it sounds like you're saying that night the Attorney General walked by Beaver's body. Can you speak to exactly how long he looked and how that conversation went with him about seeing the body or finding the body or looking for something?
Again, we're not going to go into great detail about interviews and that sort of thing. What was indicated through the phone records referenced was that there were steps taken. They would have been in the direction around and near where the body was located. Nothing was indicated that anyone that went past that scene on the night in question had seen Mr. Beaver's body.
Chris Von Drachik from Foreign News Service. Did you ever receive any pressure from the Attorney General or the Governor's office or anyone else in South Dakota to make these charges?
I have made it very clear throughout the statement that I have made a very, very specific point to separate the prosecutor's offices from any of the political officials. There's been no contact by the prosecutors with the Attorney General himself and no discussions with any political figures regarding the charging decisions.
Stephen Groves from AP. Can you tell us where Mr. Beaver's body was located in reference to the road, how far away it was from the pavement or on the shoulder?
I don't have the accident reconstruction mapping with me, but I will indicate that he was not very far outside of the lane of travel. He was off to the north shoulder.
Joe Sneevy, Argus leader. So I just want to make sure I understand this right. The charge about using a mobile device while operating a motor vehicle, that's based on the evidence you gathered for his conduct before he got to Highmore?
Correct. And as we indicated, this was an extraordinarily thorough investigation. So they had tracked essentially everything that he had done throughout the trip from he was coming from Redfield that night. The charge relating to the phone use was east of Highmore city limits and not relevant at the time of the impact.
If I can follow up with that, I think you said he was going 67 miles per hour at the time of impact. Was that the number?
Yes, and it was in a 65 mile per hour zone.
So why not a speeding charge?
Yeah, I think there's a reasonable degree of latitude that all prosecutors exercise when it comes to a 65 mile per hour zone. And I don't know very many folks that haven't gone 66 or 67 miles per hour in a 65 mile per hour zone.
Before we open up to the phone lines, are there any other first time questions in the room?
Do you know why the Attorney General wasn't able to see Joseph Beaver when he was driving? Can you speak to that?
What I can speak to is that the description of that night, it was a very dark night. This was in a rural area. It's not well lit by any artificial means. I think that there's lots of individuals that were passersby or that investigated or that they don't realize why he was not observed on the night in question. It was a dark night, and we don't have the answer to that.
Just to branch off that, I think Lee was meeting, what was he doing at the time of impact? Why didn't he see Joseph Beaver walking on the road?
I'm sorry, I misunderstood the question. I don't have the answer to that.
Austin Goss, Dakota News Now. Can you tell us what the maximum penalty is for each of those three charges?
Each of the charges, as I indicated, is a misdemeanor offense.
Yes.
Each of them has a maximum of 30 days incarceration in county jail, a $500 fine, or both of those things.
Turn your mic on. Light's not coming on. Immediately prior, while the highway goes through Highmore, the speed limit drops to 45 miles an hour. Does your telemetry data reveal how fast he was going through the 45 mile an hour zone?
I'll defer over to Mr. Moore. I don't recall offhand if we assessed. I don't remember it being any overwhelming degree of acceleration, but I will defer if he has any other better answer.
No, the evidence and the reconstruction indicated to us that he slowed down at the 45-mile-per-hour zone to approximately 45 miles an hour. When he got to the 65-mile-per-hour zone, he started speeding back up. And that's what we've had from the reconstruction.
We need to take some questions on the phone. We're going to unmute the phone lines right now. Go ahead on the phone.
Ariel with the
question.
Journal.
Ariel with the Journal.
Go ahead.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Hi. Yeah, so my two-part question. One is, how is he going to be, is there an arrest warrant? Does he have plans to turn himself in? And part two is if this was a random person, would they have been arrested and charged first and then investigated after? Or would it have been like this too, where they're living out in the community to do this extremely thorough investigation?
With respect to the first question, this has been charged out by complaint. It is highly likely that a special judge will be appointed and there will be an appropriate summons to court at that point in time. As to part two of your question, whether this would have been, somebody else would have been treated differently, the answer is no. Mr. Ravnsborg was treated no different than any other person would have been treated under these circumstances.
Another phone question?
Mark with the pioneer.
Todd Epp, Kello.com News.
Go ahead.
Yeah, you said that Ravnsborg was treated like anybody else. In this instance, it seems like he was treated much better. The sheriff allowed him to use his car to go back into town. And, you also said the investigation was extremely thorough, but the investigation wasn't thorough at the very get-go, was it? If the sheriff didn't do a breathalyzer, if the sheriff didn't do a complete look around the accident area with, you know, the high-powered flashlights that they normally have. So isn't it true that this sheriff made your jobs a lot harder and made it a lot more difficult for evidence to be gathered that might have helped you prove the elements of the crimes that could have shown that the Attorney General was responsible for the death of Mr. Beaver?
Well, you know, with any investigation, hindsight is 20/20, and things can always be done differently after we know what has occurred. To play Monday morning quarterback and say that something should have been different, I don't know. This was a call out to an accident scene in a rural area. You've listened to the 911 tape. The audio indicates that the 911 operator purports that this is maybe a deer crash, and it would not be unheard of to have law enforcement go to a situation like that, and if they have somebody that they know or are comfortable lending a vehicle to, it would not be unheard of.
Last question on the phone, Black Hills Pioneer.
It was the dispatcher who put the idea in the mind of Ravnsborg that he may have hit a deer, because in the transcript he says he doesn't know what he hit. Wouldn't it have been prudent by both Ravnsborg and the sheriff at that time to actually take a good look around to see if it was a person or if it was a wounded animal to put it out of its misery, or so it doesn't impede traffic later on that evening?
With respect to law enforcement actions and how they were notified of the accident and of what type, I'm certain that had there been suspicion that there was something other than a car deer accident, it would have been handled differently.
We're going to take two more questions. Joe Snave from Argus Leader will begin.
Okay. Did you personally talk to Ravnsborg? What did he say he was doing at the time of the impact? And secondly, is there any investigation or probe into the sheriff as well?
To my knowledge, none of the prosecutors have had any direct contact with Mr. Ravnsborg, specifically no contact with respect to the accident. And with respect to any inquiry on law enforcement, no, not to my knowledge.
Do you know what Ravnsborg told investigators he was doing at the time of the impact?
You know, I'm not going to go into the specific details of any of the interviews that were conducted.
Austin Goss, Dakota News Now. It's been circulated that it was a possibility to use a grand jury in this case. If that was the case, can you say so? And then if it was an option, why wasn't it used?
Actually, I'll defer over to Mr. Moore. He had addressed that some in his statement.
Obviously, in South Dakota, we can charge by complaint, which means that there, in a case of a felony, there would be a preliminary hearing, or we can charge by an indictment, which is presenting a case to the grand jury, which prosecutors are under an ethical obligation to only present cases that we believe meet the facts, meet the law. In a case where we don't have it, we don't have the facts, we don't have the law, we can't present a case to the grand jury. It's an ethical violation on our part to do so. And in this case, as I mentioned, it was the facts fell well short of what we needed to reach recklessness. So there would be no use in presenting this case to a grand jury.
Is there any evidence that, or any indication that the body was moved at all? Was it in one place all night long before it was noticed?
There's no indication that there was any moving of the body.
Can I get one question? Sorry. It sounds like at the conclusion of the investigation, there's still some questions that even you have as prosecutors in terms of, you know, why Mr. Ravnsborg was driving outside the lane. At the end of this, can you tell me, are you still left wondering what happened and frustrated by some of the lack of knowledge that we might have in this case?
Well, I mean, obviously, when a person dies, we want to know what happened. And but we're limited by the investigation and by the facts. And we can't compel someone to tell us. I mean, there's just nowhere else to go. And it's just, when we don't have a negligent homicide law in this state, we're faced with recklessness. And recklessness, as I've read to you, is a extremely high burden for us to establish. And in this case, we don't have it. And I know I don't feel good about it, but it's the right decision.
Before we finish, do you have any remarks before we depart or anything you'd like to clarify for the record?
I'll just follow up with very briefly with respect to the proceedings. Again, they will be public proceedings. I don't know the exact date that they will be presented to the court. I'm sure you will all be made aware of that as the case presents itself and goes forward.
Good.
Thank you.
Thank you.